So today we are going to discuss about another important topic of the data structure. We are going to discuss about a queue. As we have seen in the previous classes about the various other data structures like the linked list and the sticks we have covered. Now another data structure is the queue. So queue can be defined as that it is a linear data structure. Means the queue arranges all the data elements in the sequential manner, in the sequential order. We can understand the queue by some real examples. As we have seen that whenever we go to some cinema hall or we are going to go at the petrol pump to fuel our vehicles, so we have to stand in the queue. So if some person is standing in our front, means who is at the top of the queue will be served first. Means if we are standing in the queue at the cinema hall and the person who is standing at the first position in the queue to get the ticket will be served first, he will be get the ticket first and he will be removed first from the queue. And we have to wait for our chance to come and understand all other persons who are standing in our front will get served and removed from the queue, then only we will get the serve. So we can say that we are inserting in the queue, we get entered in the queue from the rear side, from the back side, and we deleted from the queue or come out of the queue from the front side after getting the ticket. So as you can see that there are so many examples of the queues are there that we see in our real life, that the persons are served in the sequential order in one by one manner. So same thing is available in the queue or available in the form of the data structure. So here we can represent the queue like this. Let's say this is the one of the queue. These are some data elements are here. Let's say these are the positions 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. Total 6 elements are there. We are using the array representation here to represent the queue. Let's say the values are available here. B, A, C, D, E, G. These are the values are here. So in this case, here this you can say is a front of the queue from where the element will get deleted, and here this is called a rear of a queue. So every queue that are available, whether it is a real life queue or the queues available in the system, is having the two point. One is the front, another is the rear. But in the stack we have seen that in the stack we are having only one point from where the insertion and the deletions are taken place. But in case of the queue, we are having two points, one for the insertion, one for the deletion. So every element that you want to get added into the queue has to come from the rear. When the element came from the rear, means it will get inserted in the queue, and when the purpose of that element or the work of that person is over from the queue, then he will come out of the queue. So it means he will get deleted from the queue. So insertions are taken place from the rear and the deletions are taken place from the front. So these two points are there through which we are handling the queue of the insert and the delete operation in the queue. Now here we are representing the queue with the help of the two ways. One is we can represent it with the help of the array, as we have seen this example. Another we can represent with the help of the linked list. So we start with the array representation. In the array representation, we have seen that we require one variable that is set as a front. We require another variable that is called as a rear. Now let's say initially that we are having a queue here. This is the elements are available. These are the index position of the elements. Now if there is no element is available in the queue, means queue is empty, at that time the value of front will be the minus 1, value of rear is a minus 1. So we can say this is a condition for the empty. So front and rear, if both are the minus 1, then the queue is empty. Now when the element is inserted first into the queue, so at the time that let's say element is inserted over here at the 0th position. Okay, so at that time the value of front is become 0, value of rear becomes 0. Both are set to the 1. Now as you keep on inserting the values, the value of rear keep on increasing. Let's say if I have inserted the another value, let's say C, so at that time the value of rear become 1. If I keep on inserting the values, so the value of rear is 3. So front is fixed here. As it is on this position, the element is available. As you keep on inserting the values, the value of rear keep on increasing. So at present, the element is available at the position 3. So value of rear is 3. So by this, the elements are inserted. Now if I have to insert one more element, let's say G. So at that time, as we have a free space available here, so value of rear get increased by the 1. So this way we perform the insertion, and in the same way if you have to perform the deletion from the queue, so all the deletions are taken place from the front. So first we delete the element from the front, so at that time the value of front gets increased, it will become the 1. I deleted the element from here, 0 position, the front become 1. Now if I delete one more element from here, so at that time the front will become 2. So now we are having the element at the second position, so it is the front, we are having the element up to the fourth position, so it is Z. So value of rear is 4. So all the deletions are taken place from the front, all the insertions are taken place from the rear. So this way we perform the insertion and deletion. Now actually how is all these things are taken place? Let's say initially that suppose here we talk about the insert operation. Let's say the queue is given to us. Initially if the queue is empty, we are performing the insertion. If the queue is empty, so what we will do? We will increase the front and rear. Initially both are minus 1, so we will set to the 0. But if let's say queue is full, means whenever we have to perform the insertion, we have to test for that whether there is some space is available in the queue or not. If the space is available, then we can perform the insertion. If space is not there, then the insertion is not possible. So we have to test for the space availability in the queue. So how we will do? Let's say that we are having another variable max that represents what is the maximum number of elements available in the queue. So as we are studying the array representation, that in the array the elements are from 0 to max minus 1. So we'll test initially, we'll say that if what is the variable? We'll say if the rear is equals to max minus 1. If let's say that suppose the elements are like this here, so in this case the value of front is 0, value of rear is 5. So we are having the all the space are full in the queue. So if the rear is equal to max minus 1, the rear is 5 in this case, in this example. So at that time we will say that V does not have any space, so it is the overflow and we cannot perform any insert operation and it will get exit. But let's say that if the space is available in the queue, so initially first we'll test if the front is equals to minus 1 and rear is also equals to minus 1, means initially let's say that queue is empty, no element is present, so front is minus 1, rear is minus 1. So what we'll do, we'll say front is equals to rear is equals to 0. We'll make both the front and rear at the 0 position, the first freely available space. Else, if the front and rear is not minus 1, means some element is already there. So what we'll do, as we've seen the previous example, let's say that suppose this is the case, the value of rear is let's say 3, and in this case if we want to insert the next element, so what we'll do is rear plus 1, rear will get increased by the 1, so we'll get the rear down on the next free available location on the 4th. and then we'll insert the value Q of rear. On the Q of rear, we'll put the value. The value is inserted on the next relocation, and then we'll say exit. So this way we can perform the insert operation into the queue. Right? Now let's talk about the delete operation. Let's say this is our queue. Initially, when we perform the delete operation, we have to test for the underflow. That if no element is present in the queue, then we cannot perform any delete operation further. So how we can test for the empty queue? We'll say that if the front is equals to minus 1. If the front is minus 1, it's obviously the rear will be the minus 1. Okay. Now take another case. Like, let's say this is the case in which front is minus 1, rear is minus 1. Our queue is empty. Okay. Now take another case. Let's say that suppose I am having the value over here A, B, C, D. Value of front is, let's say, 0, and value of rear is, let's say, 3. Now when we perform the deletion, front is, we'll perform the deletion from the front. So first A will get deleted, front will become 1, then B deleted, front become 2, then C deleted, front become 3. So at present front and rear both are on the position this. Okay. Now suppose I have deleted the D from here. When I delete the D from here, value of front after the deletion will become the 4. So in this case, we can say that now the value of front is greater than the rear. So another condition for the empty queue is that suppose we have performed some deletion from the queue and we have not set the value of front and rear to the minus 1. At that time, value of front and rear will be like this, that after the deletion, value of front will become higher than the rear. So you can say, and if front is minus 1 or front is greater than the rear. So if the front is greater than the rear, so we will say that there is no element is present in the queue. So write underflow and we will exit. Right? So this is the case for the empty. Now let's say that if some element is present in the queue, so we will say else. If some element is present over here, so we will say else, we will get the value from that position. Value is equals to Q. From where we will get? We will get the value from the front, because all the deletions are taken place from the front. So we will get the value from the front, and then we'll say front is equals to front plus 1. Let's say that if suppose the position is like this, the value of front is 1, rear is 3, and if you perform the deletion, so the front is represented here, so we'll get the value from the front and store that value into the variable well, and then increase the front by the 1. So now the front will become 2 and the element will be deleted from there. And then it is simple. So this way we can perform the delete operation from the queue. Now let's say that suppose I am having the position of the queue like this, that initially front is 0 and rear is 3. Now if I have inserted some element in this, so let's say E and F, I have inserted the value, so value of here becomes a 5. So now my queue is full, We have seen the condition that if the rear is equal to max minus 1, so our cube is full. Right? The condition we have seen that if the rear is equal to max minus 1, means our cube is full. Okay. So this is the same case here. Now if I have deleted the some element from here, now the value of front and rear like this, front is 2, rear is 5. Again, now if you try to insert a new element into the cube, we have to build test if the rear is equal to max minus 1, the condition is true, rear is equal to max minus 1. So we cannot insert a new element into the cube, although we are having the 2 free space available over here in the cube. Means it is a limitation. We can say that even if we are having the free space available in the cube, then also we are not able to insert any more further element. As the condition we are given is a rear is equal to max minus 1, so that indicates that our cube is full. But we are having the free space available there. So what we can do? There are the two possibilities over here. One possibility is that either we shift all the elements of the cube to the front side. So in this case, if we have shifted all the elements of the cube to the front side, then it will become like this. 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. The value of front will become 0. Value of rear is equal to 3. This is the one possibility that either we shift all the elements of the cube to the front side, to the 0th position. Like in the normal way, we have seen that if any element from the front get deleted, all the person gets shifted in the cube to the forward side. So same thing we can do. But in this case, what is the problem is that if the size of the cube is very small, then we can perform this shifting of the element. But if the, suppose the size of the cube is very large, then all this shifting will take the time. We have to shift all the elements one by one to the forward side, so it is more time consuming approach. So another approach that we can take over here, that if we have this kind of a situation, so instead of maintaining a simple linear cube, we will maintain a circular cube. We will maintain a circular cube. So circular cube is actually represented like this. Here, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Let's say this is position 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. The same we represented over here, right? Now we are having the position from the 2, so you can say C, D, E, and F. So now we represent the same linear cube in the form of the circular cube. So in the circular cube, what happens that the last element of the cube is linked with the first element. So here the last element, 5th, is linked with the first element, the 0th element over here in the cube. Right? So now here the value of front is 2, rear is equal to 5. Now let's say that if now my new element is come and I want to insert that element, so I will test the all the instructions are taken place from the rear. So here the value of rear is 5. Now if the rear is 5, so I will make the rear value as a 0 and insert the new element over here at the 0th position. So now my rear is become 0. If the next element come, I make the free space over here, so I can insert the new value here at 8 and rear become 5. So in this way we are able to utilize the free space. In this case we can see that if the free space available, then also we are not able to insert. But in this case, if we link the last element of the cube to the first element, then we can perform the insertion in this way. So now the rear is 1, front is 2. So this is the modification over here. So we can represent the circular cube like this. Now how we can perform the insert and delete operation in the cube? So let's say that we are talking about the insert operation. In the insert operation, the normal thing is that first we have to test that whether our cube is empty, means if there is no element in the cube, means if the front is minus 1, rear is minus 1. So what we'll do? We'll set both the front and rear to the zero. Is now same relation we have seen previously. Second position is that if there is some element is already present over there, so at that time we will say when you perform the insertion, rear is equals to rear plus 1. Now another condition is that we have to test for the full Q. Whenever you perform the insertion, we have to test for the full Q. What is the condition for the full Q? One is that if the front is 0 and rear is equals to max minus 1. So this is the one condition for the full Q. It is normal that we have seen in the simple linear Q. Another condition for the full Q is that this is the case you can see. Here you can see the value of front is 2, rear is 1 and our Q is full. So we can define over here that if the front is equals to rear plus 1, so this is another condition for the full Q, that front is equals to rear plus 1. So we are in the two conditions over here. If the front is 0 and rear is max minus 1, so Q is full, or if the front is equals to rear plus 1, then our Q is full. Another thing is here, as we have seen in the previous example just now, that when our rear is at the 5 and we inserted the new element, so rear is shifted from 5 to 0. So we can say here that if my rear is equals to max minus 1, and if you try to insert the new element, at that time my rear will become 0. I will shift the rear to the next free location in the cube at the start. So these are some modifications that we have seen in the case of the insert operation. Let's say we will write the algorithm for this. First, we will test for the full cube. So if front is equals to 0 and rear is equals to max minus 1, or we can say if the front is equals to rear plus 1. These are the two conditions here. Then we'll say right over and exit. So this is the first condition. Every time we have to test for the full. Now, if there is no element in the queue, means if the front is equals to minus 1 and rear is equals to minus 1, then if both the front and rear are minus 1, means the queue is empty, so we will say front is equals to rear is equals to 0. We will set both the variables to the 0. As we will say if the rear is equals to max minus 1 and front is not equals to 0. As the case we have seen, that we are in the rear on the 5 and our front is at the 2. Means we have the free space over here. So what we have done? We shifted the rear from 5 to 0. So same here, that if the rear is equals to max minus 1 and the front is not equals to 0, then we will say rear will be come at the 0. As the other condition we have seen, that is there is some free space available over there, so we will simply shift rear is equals to rear plus 1. And then third exit. Sorry, before this, one more thing we have to write. We shifted the position values. Another thing is on that rear store the value and then exit. this is the way we perform the insert operation into the circular tree. Now the delete operation into the circular tree. How the deletions are taken place? First thing we have to test that whenever we have performed the deletion, we have to test for the empty queue. And what is the condition for the empty queue? The condition for the empty queue is that first thing is that if the front is equal to minus 1, then simply that our queue is empty. Okay. Second thing we have to test that let's take the case. In this case, we are having a single element here. Front is 1, rear is 1. And when we perform the deletion, so at that time, when we perform the deletion from here, we are having a single element, front and rear, both are pointing to the same position and single element is there. If we perform the deletion, so at that time, if we say if the front is equal to rear, so after the deletion, both the front and the rear will be set to the minus 1. Third thing, let's say that suppose we are having some element over here, H. When your front is, let's say some element over here, value of front is 5, rear is 4. Front is 5, rear is 4. And when we perform the deletion, when we perform the deletion from here, so this will get deleted from here, and the value of front, which is 5, will become 0. So you will say that if the front is equal to max minus 1, front is already at the last point of the queue of the array, so at a time we set the front to the 0. Or simple another condition is simply we perform front is equal to front plus 1. So these are the four conditions you have to perform in the case of the circular queue or the deletion. So let's write out the algorithm for this. First we'll test for the empty queue. So if front is equal to minus 1, then write underflow and exit. Second, we'll take the value from the queue on that front position. From the front, we'll take the value. Then we'll test if the front is equal to rear. Means if you have a single element left, so front is equal to rear, they are pointing to the same position. So we'll say then both the front and the rear they will become minus 1. Else we'll say if the front is equal to max minus 1, means as we see the example just now, that if the front is equal to max minus 1, then we'll set the front to the 0. Else we'll say front is equal to front plus 1, and then next is the exit. So this is the way we perform the deletion operation in the circular queue. So this we have seen the area representation of a cube. Now we'll talk about a linked list representation. In the linked list representation, if we study the linked list, now here every node or every value is represented in the terms of a node. Here it is a linked list. Now as you see that in the queue we are under two. Now what is the limitation? Why we are using the linked list? Let's say that if you have seen the array representation of a queue, in this case what are the problems we can face here? That suppose we have declared a array of size, let's say 50, and our queue is occupying only the 25 elements out of 50. So what about the remaining 25? Those remaining 25 elements are just the wastage of the memory, because we are not utilizing the full 50 elements space that we declare with the declaration of the array. Q is occupying only the 25 or even less than that. So we are having the wastage of the rest of the elements of the memory. Okay. Now let's say that suppose I have declared the array of size 10 elements. When I am creating the queue, now in the queue I am having more number of elements, means within the 10 elements of the array I cannot accommodate my complete queue. I need more space over here. My queue is frequently varying or frequently increasing the size, then the fixed size of the array representation is not useful, because every time I need to modify the queue, every time I need to modify the array, and it is more time consuming approach in my program. So by array declaration, sometimes it may possible that we are having the wastage of the memory, or sometimes it may possible that we cannot accommodate the complete queue within the array size declared. So what we want, that we want that what are the number of elements are there, that size of the queue will get created automatically with the dynamic memory allocation. Means as the requirement has come to add the some element in the queue, my size of the queue get increased dynamically. So in this case, I am free from the fixed size memory location that we have seen with the case of the array representation. So array representation is useful only when we are having the size of the queue is very small, or we know the number of elements of the queue in the advance. But if we don't know the number of elements of the queue in the advance, so at that time we have to go with the linked list representation. So in the linked list representation, suppose we look at the linked list like this. So in the queue we have seen that we are in the two ends, front and the rear. So the same thing is represented over here, that the start of a linked list is now represented with the help of a front. So now the front will point to the first node, as we have seen the start in the case of a linked list. So that is represented here as a front, and the rear will point to the last node of a linked list. Now all the deletion will take place from the front, all the insertion will take place from the rear. And every node is having two part, one is the data part, another is the pointer to the next node or the next part. Okay. Now here again let's see that how to perform the insert operation in the queue with the help of the linked list. So first thing we have to do, that whenever we perform the insert operation, we have to get the memory from the system. So we'll say we'll create a new node. So if avail is equals to null, then write overflow and exit. If you are not able to get the memory from the system, so we will say overflow and we will exit from there. Otherwise we will create a new node, assign the memory from the avail, we'll move the avail pointer to the next free available location, so avail equals to avail of next. Then at the new node of the data part, we'll store our value. So we'll create a new node over here, and in the new node of data part will store our value. Now let's say that if we are inserting this our first node of the queue, or these are the first element we are inserting in the queue at that time. So if this is our first element, so at that time the value of front will be null. Means there is no node, so front is pointing to the null. So if the front is goes to null, then so we are inserting the first node over here, front is equal to null. So at that time, so both the front is equal to here is equal to new node. Both that front and here will point to the first node that we inserted into the and the front of next is equal to rear of next will be null. Means if initially front is null, rear is null, and we created a new node. So at the time the front will point to this, rear will point to this, this null value is emitted over here, and the front of next and rear of next both will be the null. So same thing will happen. Now if it is not a first node, means some node is already present in our queue and we are inserting the new node over there. So obviously the new node is inserted in the rear side. So at that time the we will say rear of next is equals to, now we will insert a new node on here. So rear of next is equals to new node. So now this rear of next will point to this new node. Rear is equals to rear of next. Now this rear will come to this, equals to rear of next, and rear of next will become null. And then sixth exit. So this way we can perform the insert operation in the queue with the help of a linked list. Now let's say we talk about the delete operation in this queue. So how the deletion is taken place? Here we are talking about a queue. Means in the case of the linked list, there is no use of the circular queue. We are simply talking about the queue. So let's say delete operation. So whenever we perform the delete operation, first we have to test for the empty queue. That if the queue is empty, then we cannot perform any more deletion. So first we will test. And what is the condition? How we will test for the empty queue? That is the front and the rear both are the null. So we will say if front is equals to null, then right underflow and exit. Okay. Otherwise, if some element is present, so if the element is present, so at that time when we perform the deletion of the first node will be done as the deletion of the second node from the front. So this node will get deleted and front will shift to the next position, next node. And this node will be deallocated, so we require one pointer over here, PTR. That will point to this and then front will shift to the next node. And then we will deallocate the memory from the PTR. So we will say here, PTR is equals to front, PTR is again pointing to the first node. Then we will say front is equals to front of next. Now the front which is pointing to the first node now point to the second node, front equals to front of next. Then we will say free PTR. And fifth is exit. So this way you can perform the delete operation in the queue with the help of a linked list. Now there are some more variations out there in the queue. One is the D queue, that is the double-ended queue, in which we can perform the insertion and the deletion from the both the side. As in the case of these queues, we have seen that we can perform the insertion from the one side and deletion from the other side. But in the case of the D queue, we can perform the insert and delete operation from the both the end of a queue. Right? Then another variations over here of the queue is the priority queue, in which every element has assigned a priority and the queue elements are deleted from the queue based on their priority values. So with this, we complete our lecture.